in a short time. So now it has grown to an exponential growth, but it has grown. The number has been increased. Next question. So the red flags of ROCM in the setting of COVID-19 is first important is that the COVID care team, which includes all of us, must be aware of the warning symptoms and signs of ROCM. We should have a very high index of suspicion of ROCM because it is obviously it's lethal actually. So we should have a very high index of suspicion. And immediate otorhinolaryngological with ophthalmological consultation is warranted. And explanation, this is important while we are dealing with COVID patients. While the patients are being discharged, you should give in writing the explanation of early warning signs in patients and the family on discharge following COVID treatment of following the treatment of COVID-19. Next, these are the common presenting pictures which we receive in our OPDs related to this. The first, the most common is you can see on the top right side. The second diagram is the commonest one. The involvement of eye, which is seen as proptosis, and the second common sign is the palatal charring, which you can easily see. The palate becomes discolored, black. And third, which is very rarely observed, not rarely, but it is less commonly observed, is the facial swelling and the infection with discoloration over the face, which is the first diagram. So in this, what we are seeing these days in the ocular symptoms, we have seen that it has some sort of predisposition for the left side, even though the diagram it has shown in the right side. But somewhere in the recent in the last 2 months, there are various articles stating that it has a predisposition towards the left side, but the reason is still being unknown. So this is one of the things which we have seen in our routine practices. Here also we have in Toto we have seen around 15 to 20 cases in which most of the patients other than 3 or 4 are left-sided predisposition. Next. So this is the next common symptom which is often missed in our practices, which is the nasal charring sign. So this is basically a crusting which we commonly tend to miss because we in COVID times we are not seeing the patient in very close up. So we tend to miss. So even if we miss, we can easily see this in our OPD consultation. So this is a charring which we can easily see. Sometimes the patients come with bleeding of this charring when the charring is being removed. So we'll go towards the signs and symptoms. So the warning symptoms and signs of ROCM are nasal stuffiness, foul smelling, discharge, and epistaxis. The nasal discharge are mucoid, purulent, or blood stains or black. So most of the symptoms which we have seen in the nasal one is not very specific, but a black tinged discharge is hinting too much towards this ROCM. So next is nasal mucosal erythema, which is basically a which we can see as a erythema, which we can see over the nose, bridge of the nose, and surrounding around the nose as well as the eye. Inflammation, discoloration, whitish ulcer, and ischemia or ESHA. So next, towards the ocular symptoms are eyelid, periocular, and facial edema. This is a common symptom. So similarly, eyelid, periocular, and facial discoloration. And these are regional pain in which the orbit, paranasal sinuses, and dental pain. The most common thing is first the patient presents as pain and later on the patient presents with paresthesia or anesthesia of the same area. So next is facial pain, and when the patient when the symptoms have gone towards the eye, obviously the worsening of headache and proptosis, sudden loss of vision, facial paresthesia, anesthesia, sudden ptosis, ocular motility restriction, diplopia, facial palsy. And this is uncommon, but this is a dreaded symptom, which is last one: fever, altered sensorium, paralysis, and focal seizures. Among these all symptoms, what we commonly see are the black discharge, nasal mucosal erythema, worsening headache, sudden loss of vision, facial paresthesia, and anesthesia. These are the common symptoms. Next, please. So diagnosis of ROCM is three pronged. First, high clinical index of suspicion. Whenever there is in a patient, we go towards the diagnostic nasal endoscopy. So whenever there is a diagnostic nasal endoscopy, we tend to find that there is a dark eschar in over the turbinate. Commonly, it starts with the lateral wall, and then it proceeds towards the turbinate and towards the septal mucosa. Second is the second thing is sampling of the tissue, which we have seen during the endoscopy. In this sampling, we see that wherever there is an active change, the specimen taken from those sites give better results rather than the dead eschar. Because the dead eschar doesn't yield much results for diagnosis. The third prong is the radiology, which is the most important one after endoscopy, because sampling takes time. Diagnostic nasal endoscopy and radiology doesn't take time. So this is more critical for the patients who are already in a condition, in a dreaded condition. Next slide. So this is the picture of diagnostic nasal endoscopy, which reveals black brown crusting and tenacious pus filling up the nasal cavity, erosion of turbinate, and nasal septal perforation. One patient also showed like a hard palate and eschar formation, but this is a very classical picture of mucormycosis affecting the sinuses and nose. So the diagnostic technique, what we see, we take the during the endoscopy, we can take the active site for direct microscopy of the deep or endoscopy guided nasal swab, paranasal sinuses, or orbital tissue using a KOH mount and fluorescence brightness such as calcofluor white, the tool for rapid diagnosis. The key diagnostic feature is non-septate or septate, irregular ribbon-like hyphae. This is a classical one, ribbon-like hyphae. Wide angle or of non-dichotomous branching and greater hyphal diameter as compared to other filamental fungi. So these things are better known to the microbiologist whom we are dealing with, but we should know whenever they write these things that what we have to look for in the part of diagnosis. So this the direct microscopy has about 90% sensitivity. So, but we, even after it has 90% sensitivity, we cannot wait for the diagnosis for these things. So we require diagnostic nasal endoscopy and imaging as the first hand diagnostic tool. Obtaining the swab from clinically active lesions. See, this is the reason where it is 90% sensitivity. Obtaining the swab from clinically active lesions under endoscopy guidance may help improve the diagnostic yield. Next, please. So the culture what we take should be from a deep or endoscopic guided nasal swab, paranasal sinuses, or orbital tissues. So the species identification and antifungal susceptibility testing. This is important for the next, if there is any change in the diagnosis from what we are thinking, it can tell about the species identification and susceptibility testing. So even after whatever said and done in the part of his culture, only about 50% of samples only 50% from samples of cases of probable ROCM grow the organism on culture. So, because most of the time the culture or sample are being taken from clinically inactive part. So we have to see that whenever it is taken to a clinically active part of the fish of the leader. May help improve the diagnostic yield. So this is the newer modality which is still under study, molecular diagnostic of tissue sampling. The culture deep or endoscopy guided nasal swab, paranasal sinuses or orbital tissue, culture or blood. The molecular diagnostic kits are not widely available commercially, so it is not much in wide practice currently, but it has a promising role for quantitative PCR. Molecular diagnostic have about 75% sensitivity and can be used with for confirmation of diagnosis wherever available. Next please. Next comes the role of histopathology. So histopathology with HE stain, FAS and Gromit, Gomori, Methamini, silver special stain. So what we tend to see, the histopathology sometimes gives a mixed reporting because it has a HR along with the microorganisms there. And the hyphae showing tissue invasion, this is a classical in the histopathology area. It is showing tissue invasion, which is confirmatory of invasive ROCM. And second thing, hyphae appears ribbon-like with an irregular pattern of branching. Again, the histopathology provides diagnostic information in only about 80% of samples of probable ROCM. So we are seeing it is only the diagnostic tool of culture and histopathology yields about 80% and is time-taking. So again, we stress upon early diagnosis and treatment. So we have to rely upon endoscopy and imaging. Next, please. So next is the most important tool is imaging. So what we tend to see, there are two imaging modalities, the contrast enhanced MRI and CT scan. So contrast enhanced MRI is a preferred, always preferable over CT scan if we have high index of suspicion of neuroma-mycosis. So what we tend to see are irregular patchy enhancement. This is an early sign in case of nasal and paranasal sinus mucosa. Whenever we see this irregular patchy enhancement, we have to go for endoscopy straight away so that we can treat the patient at the earliest. So second, what we see is ischemia and non-enhancement of terminal. This is an early sentinel sign, which is on the MRI post staining is called as black turbinate sign. This is a classical picture of mucus. The third is sinus opacification. The fluid level in the sinus and partial or complete sinus opacification signifies the involvement of paranasal sinuses. But what we tend to see, this fluid level in the sinus is also commonly is seen in CRS, which is called as chronic rhinosinusitis. So this is not a classical thing. The sinus opacification is obviously signifies that there is involvement of paranasal sinuses. So next important thing in the orbital part is thickening of medial rectus, which is an early sign of orbital invasion. So next to go is fat. So thereby there is a patchy enhancement of orbital fat or any lesion in the area of superior inferior orbital feature and the orbital apex. There is a classical bone dissection at the paranasal sinuses and the orbit, which indicates advanced disease. So next, what we see in the orbital imaging is stretching of the optic nerve and tenting of the posterior pole. So if these things are already seen, what we want to... If these things are already available, what we want to see next, if there is any involvement of cavernous sinus and the extent of the involvement. So we go for MRI and MR angiography and venography to know the ischemic damage to the CNS. So this is important. The last point, the absence of sinus involvement has a strong negative predictive value of ROCM, because the starting point are more often than not are the lateral wall of the nose and the sinuses. So obviously the first initial point should be the nasal lateral wall and sinus. If the sinus is not involved, there is a strong negative predictive value for ROCM. So comparative imaging over time helps monitor the course. So this is important point, that whenever we do the treatment of this ROCM, the post-op also, we have to have a comparative imaging over time, which helps to monitor the course of disease. However, this is not absolute. The radiological resolution lags clinical resolution. The patient is saying that, you know, we can see the patient improving, but whenever we see the signs and symptoms in the MRI, we tend to see that there is still the fungal hyphae present, or so this is not a very accurate tool. The accurate tool post-operative to visualize is endoscopy. So next point is that there are in all the imaging, the most three important points are that on T2 weightage, there is an enhancement.
Akhil, your slide is not moving. Yes, now it is.
What we see is in T2, we see the hyper intense content in the sinuses. So this is the T2 weighted, and next one is also T2 weighted, in which we see it is hyper intense. So when we go with the post gadolinium staining, these things are suppressed. So post contrast sequences show non enhancing angioinvasive mass fungal infection, because mucor is one of the such fungal infection which is already angioinvasive, and so it doesn't take up the stain. So this gives a classical black turbinate sign. So this is the differentiating feature for our mucormycosis, T2 versus T1 post gadolinium. So in cases of MRI for the orbit, it is showing, in this case, showing a hyper intensity of the ethmoid, nasal sinuses, and also of the retroverbal space. In the right image, we can see there is a irregular hyper intensity of the retrobulbar space. So obviously it has superseded the sinuses and went into the orbit. So next, after imaging modalities, now once the diagnosis have been made, we want to go for the treatment and prognostication part. So we require a classical staging, which is not available in for the ROCM. So it is still in the still we are combining the cases to make a staging. So I have got this staging system from one of our seniors in the ophthalmic league. The staging system can be devised as per anatomical progression and severity of ROCM. From the point of entry, that is nasal mucosa, to paranasal sinuses, to then orbit, and then the brain. So accordingly, symptoms, signs, diagnostic tools, preferred management, and outcomes and prognostication is there. Next, please. So this is the staging what we are seeing. The stage one, stage, these stages are not yet defined, but this is for our convenience that we have labeled it as stage one and stage two, and stage three and stage four. So first is obviously involvement of nasal mucosa. Then we go towards paranasal sinuses, stage two. Stage three, we go towards the orbit, and stage three, we go towards the stage four, towards the intracranial thing. So obviously the symptom course gets accordingly towards the stage whichever is involved. So stage one, involvement of nasal mucosa, therefore the symptoms would be pertinent to the nasal mucosa, that is nasal stuffiness, discharge, foul smell, and epistaxis. The signs obviously would be again the foul smelling sticky mucoid or black distinct, granular and hemorrhagic nasal discharge. While it's just blue discoloration, pale color, anesthesia, and ischemia HR. So whatever said and done, in the stage one, sometimes the patient comes with the history of epistaxis. We often tend to miss that, thinking that this is only epistaxis and we don't enter our endoscope in it. When we enter the endoscope, we directly see that it is not just the mucoid or black tinge discharge, but it is actually an HR which is present there. So then we progress towards the primary assessment. The primary assessment is diagnostic nasal endoscopy, contrast enhanced MRI preferred over CT. See, again we see that MRI is preferred over CT for two reasons. First is CT scan cannot differentiate exactly the areas which we want to address during our surgery if it turns out to be a mucormycosis with a high index of suspicion. So this is one of the reasons. Second thing, the MRI has very clear cut non-enhancing sign of black turbinate, which we tend to see in MRI. So these two are the common things why we prefer MRI over CT scan. Confirmation of diagnosis, again the deep nasal swab or endoscopy guided nasal swab or nasal biopsy or directed biopsy, culture and molecular diagnostics, nasal mucosal biopsy for rapid histopathological with special stain. So sometimes we tend to see that in the MRI or CT we are not able to appreciate exactly, but it has started towards the turbinate. So we have to take histopathology from most prominent and erythematous area, which is obviously seen only in the endoscopy. When we see in the endoscopy, we see that this is actually not an HR, but the changes have begun. So we take the biopsy from that area, especially in the lateral wall area. And now we come to the stage two, that is involvement of paranasal sinuses. So obviously, it is again the staging can be made as whenever one sinus is involved, it can be said as 2A. When two sinuses can be involved, it can be labeled as 2B. When more than two ipsilateral sinuses are involved or palate or oral cavity, it is 2C. And similarly, 2D can be labeled as bilateral paranasal sinuses involvement of zygoma or mandible. So these are not hard and fast stages as we have seen in carcinoma cases. This is not a classification as such. This is just for our convenience that we are staging these things as 2A, 2B, 2C, 2D. So again, symptomatologically, we will see all the symptoms which we have seen previously, plus facial pain, edema, dental pain, and systemic symptoms, because obviously it has involved sinuses and the sinuses can lead to can help in the collection of fluid. So obviously it will have the systemic symptoms as well. So signs in the stage one, we see the signs in the stage one, unilateral or bilateral, localized facial edema, edema localized over the sinuses, and sinus tenderness. So assessment, again, we can do the same, endoscopy, MRI with CT. Confirmation of diagnosis also same. One additional thing is that if the disease has reached the sinuses, obviously we can take a sinus biopsy, but sinuses cannot be entered without entering the nasal cavity. So again, we have to take a HPE and culture from the nasal cavity and sinus. So it is written same as stage one plus sinus biopsy. Next is, so towards the stage three, we see there is an involvement of orbit. Obviously, then whenever there is an involvement of orbit, as we saw in the CT scans also, first thing to involve is the medial area because it is going from the nose towards the orbit. So first is involvement is NLD, medial orbit, and vision unaffected still, that is 3A. When diffuse or orbital involvement is there, more than one or two quadrant, then the vision is still unaffected. When 3C, when the central retinal artery or ophthalmic artery occlusion is there, or superior ophthalmic vein, thrombosis, involvement of superior orbital feature and immediate inferior orbital feature, orbital effect, then there is obviously a loss of vision. And 3D is the bilateral orbital involvement. So similarly, the symptoms would be again same as we stage 1 and stage 2, plus obviously the ocular symptoms, which are pain in the eyes, proptosis, ptosis, diplopia, loss of vision, and infraorbital and facial V1, V2 nerve anesthesia. So signs obviously would be again same as in stage 1 and stage 2, but additionally, there would be signs related to ocular motility, restriction, ptosis, proptosis, infraorbital nerve anesthesia, CRAO, features of ophthalmic artery occlusion, and superior ophthalmic vein thrombosis, V1, V2 nerve anesthesia, and features of 3, 4, 6 cranial nerve palsy, indicating the orbital effect, superior orbital fissure involved. The diagnosis is obviously same as the diagnosis in nasal endoscopy, contrast analysis MRI, referred over CT scans. Yes, or the same. Same as the stage 2 and orbital biopsy if indicated and if feasible. So again, we see rarely that the orbit is solely affected. More often than not, we see it is going from the nasal lateral wall towards the orbit. So whenever we take the orbital biopsy, we tend to take the endoscopic biopsy from nasal cavity as well. The stage 4 now is the involvement of CNS. So CNS, it can be focal or partial cavernous sinus involvement. Or stage 4B, it can be diffuse. Stage 4C, it can go beyond the cavernous sinus. And stage 4D is multifocal or diffuse CNS disease. Symptoms would be obviously the same plus the CNS symptoms. That is paralysis, altered consciousness, and focal seizures. The patient which came to us was in same state. He was in proptosis with paralysis with altered consciousness. This was the reason we had to operate in one such patient in neuromyopathy. So the signs in stage 1, 2, 3 plus the symptoms plus the signs of involvement of cranial nerve. So diagnosis would be again same, and the diagnostic modality would be same as contrast analysis, MRI, and CT. Next step. So the management of ROCM would be depending upon whether it's a possible ROCM, probable ROCM, or proven ROCM. So basically, what is called as possible? Possible when you see the symptoms and signs in the clinical setting, and the patient has been recently treated with COVID. He is a diabetic patient. Immunosuppression drugs has there, and systemic steroids had been used. Mechanical ventilation or supplemental oxygen had been given. So the basically the predisposing factors for ROCM are there. So we take it as a possible ROCM. But yet there is no supportive evidence on diagnostic nasal endoscopy or MRI or CT, neither imaging nor endoscopy. But we will keep it as a possible ROCM because he has predisposition factors and as well as symptoms and signs. So then either it can go to ROCM unlikely or ROCM probable, depending upon close observation. We will keep the patient in close observation. Again, we will do an endoscopy after 24 hours and repeated MRI after 3 days. If it turns out to be a probable ROCM, then we will treat it as a ROCM. And again, if it is not coming at a ROCM, we will not leave the patient yet. We will continue the observation for 3 weeks. So when it comes, and second is probable ROCM. So obviously, when it is a probable ROCM, we can see what is probable ROCM. It is supportive evidence clinically and diagnostic nasal endoscopy with imaging. But yet, there is no evidence on direct microscopy or culture or histopathology with special stains or molecular diagnosis. So, if the patient is having a supportive diagnostic endoscopy and MRI, we can directly jump towards the treatment. We cannot wait for this because we have already seen in the previous slide that the culture and histopathology are giving only in 50 to 80% patients, they are sensitive enough, but 20% still they are not sufficient. So we have to jump directly towards the induction therapy. With this is a treatment. What I am telling is a IV liposomal amphotericin B, which is around starting from 3 to 5, and it can be exceeded to 10 mg per kg body weight with obviously strict metabolic control, as the amphotericin is nephrotoxic as well. So amphotericin B deoxycholate or amphotericin B lipid complex are less expensive but obviously less effective and more toxic. So what we tend to see, if amphotericin B is contraindicated because of renal impaired renal function, we tend to give posaconazole and isavuconazole 300 milligrams twice a day on day 1, followed by 300 once a day for day 2. Till the time the patient has been prepared and optimized for surgery, because more often than not, we see that these patients are highly diabetic, kidney functions are deranged, and there are multiple comorbidities. So we have to, sometimes we have to wait for a day for, but we want to take the surgery as fast as possible. But obviously, because of the comorbidities, we have to buy time. So we have to start this drug immediately. And in cases of third is a proven ROCM. Proven is means that we have a confirmation in the way of direct microscopy or culture or histopathology. So this is a case of when we do a proven ROCM, again, the treatment is going to be the same. So obviously, it is better that we treat early to prevent delayed complications. So obviously, we have to go with diagnostic endoscopy and MRI or CT to start the treatment, early treatment. Next slide, please. Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Immediate induction therapy with IV liposomal amphotericin, what we were talking, or then stage 1 and 2 according to the staging. According to the staging, what we tend to see is important is stage 1, 2, 3A and B. Predominantly, that is sinonasal manifestation. So there is no or limited involvement of orbit, and vision is preserved. So what we'll do are early and aggressive debridement of paranasal sinuses by an appropriate surgical approach, that is endoscopy, turbinectomy, palatal resection, and medial orbital wall resection with clean margins. So we will follow up if there we have a suspicion for intraorbital involvement, then we can obviously give plus minus retrobulbar amphotericin B 3.5 mg per ml plus minus sinus irrigation with amphotericin B 1 mg per ml endoscopy and plus minus MRI CT guided debridement. If it and then we follow up with metabolic condition stabilizers, then there is no disease progression and the documented improvement, we continue with the induction therapy. And if there is, the stage is obviously higher, stage 3A to C, disease progression and worsening of the orbital component, we have to go for orbital excentration. Plus, the things we have already done in sinus irrigation with amphotericin B and MR guided debridement. In stage 3C or D, we have to go for extensive orbital, when there is extensive orbital involvement, whether it is no or limited CNS involvement or there is extensive CNS involvement. According to it, we can go for orbital excentration plus aggressive debridement of paranasal sinuses, which we have already done, plus minus palatal resection as required, plus minus orbital resection with clean margin. And if there is involvement of CNS involvement, the surgery is systemic condition permit. If the, that is orbital excentration with aggressive debridement of paranasal sinuses with which we have already done as turbinectomy, palatal resection, plus minus orbital resection with clean margin, followed by supportive
surgery.
what the treatment modalities we have already discussed are urgent medical management followed by optimization. Optimization is with special emphasis on RFT and sugar, because these are more often than not problematic in such patients which are post-COVID and had a dose of steroids and diabetic patients. And third is extensive debridement. These three are the treatment modalities. The urgent medical follow-up, second is optimization, and third is extensive debridement, be it endoscopic, plus minus open, whatever is required as per patient. Next, please. So the medical management, obviously, as we have told, are amphotericin B and posaconazole. The surgical treatment is obviously to remove the fungal debris and HR. So we have to see, these are three things which we have to discuss in the case of surgical part, that is endoscopic versus open versus combined. The goal obviously is to remove up to the visualization. So obviously, in a whichever way we can get the best visualization, we can have the maximum clearance with maximum salvage. So obviously the endoscopic approach is always favorable whenever feasible over open or combined approach. So more often than not, we tend to see whenever the disease has progressed, we have to obviously combine the external incision. So obviously it becomes endoscopic plus open, which is equal to combined approach. So the third thing is orbital clearance versus orbital exaggeration. So this is the important part, that if we are going by the endoscopic approach, we can reach the orbital clearance rather than the orbital exaggeration. So we can at least try to salvage the eye. And if it is not, if the orbital apex or cavernous are all obviously involved, then we will convert that surgery to an orbital exaggeration. Otherwise, we can clear the orbital by the way of endoscopic approach. So the endoscopic approach is the most important part, because endoscopic approach is the thing which is clearing the sinuses, which is clearing the nasal passage, and obviously and clearing the orbital part and salvaging the orbit if the disease is not reached the orbital apex. So obviously endoscopic approach has advantages, which is visualization. The visualization is the most important part which an endoscopic approach gives. Again, as a visualization during the surgery as well as post-operative, in which we have a second look, third look, whatever. So we cannot get the MRI done every day. So what we can do best is by a visualization with the endoscopic picture, and second thing why endoscopic approach is important is preservation. Preservation of critical structures which are closely abutting but yet not involved, especially in case of orbital involvement. Third is hidden areas, like in pterygoid areas. The hidden areas can be only accessed with proper visualization only. So more often than not, we tend to see that whenever there is an open approach, these areas bleed and we are not able to approach these areas clearly. And we have some or the other nerve palsies which could have been preserved. So fourth important are the critical areas. Critical areas, obviously, which are near the orbital apex. So the tools required, which are the keys to the endoscopic visualization and surgical outcome. What we want to do is endoscopic clearance. So we require high definition visualization. This is most important, which most of our centers are lacking. You know, we are very fortunate enough that we have a HD visualization system here. The second thing is cobulator assistance, which is bloodless field, because we require that bloodless field for, obviously it is a bloodless field because the fungus is not bleeding, but we want a bloodless field post-operative as well. And there is no charring. This is very important. The cobulator assistance is very important. Why? Because when we tend to remove this thing by cautery, these things char. So post-operative, when we do an endoscopy, we could not differentiate between the new fungus and this charge as well till the patient has been receiving the histopathology or culture of this charge areas. And third important thing is microdebrider. Microdebrider is a big good power tool so that we can remove the areas under visualization. So these three things are one of the most, these three are the pillars for good endoscopic visualization and good surgical outcome for the any mucormycosis case or beat any endoscopic cases or tumor. So these things are most important too. Next please. Next we go towards the open approach when we need to combine it with the endoscopic approaches. This is a exenteration which is lid sparing exenteration that we have done. So next slide. So last thing what we all wanted to know is ROCM can be prevented or not. So obviously, it's a difficult question in such cases because judicious and supervised use of systemic steroids in compliance with current preferred practice guidelines. So this is a very this line what I've written is very easy to say, but it's very difficult to monitor. What is the supervised use of systemic steroids? Because most of the time we tend to see that when the patient is in COVID, because we have recently got these mucormycosis cases booming. Otherwise, we had been using the systemic steroids from the time we have started this COVID treatment. But recently, we have seen a boom of these cases because of the systemic steroid. We don't know exactly, be it systemic steroid, be it diabetes or be it immunosuppressant, whatever. So what we tend to see is supervised use is one of the most important things because most of the time we are seeing that steroids are being used injudiciously. So next thing is judicious and supervised use of this is not available in most of the centers, but wherever used, it has to be used in the supervised areas in surveillance with current preferred practice guidelines. Third important is aggressive monitor and control of diabetes mellitus. This is also a two-edged sword, like the systemic steroids are two-edged sword. Once they are giving diabetes mellitus, and second, they are saving lives as well. So it's very difficult to balance these things. So most of the time, patients tend to get these mucormycosis. Six aseptic precautions while administering oxygen. Sterile water for the humidifier, daily change of sterilized humidifier of the tube. And next is personal and environmental hygiene. And one thing what in our ENT practice, we have seen that betadine mouth gargle also twice a day or even twice a day, we have seen to tend to decrease these things. And there's a barrier mask covering the nose and mouth, obviously. Consider prophylactic oral posaconazole in high-risk patients with more than 3 weeks of mechanical ventilation. But the dose still is not very clear of this prophylactic. It is still in the understudy only. So we are still not very sure about the doses and which is the patient. Which patient selection still is not very good. So again, we are going towards the same thing. Now, first we saw the misuse of the systemic steroids. We don't want to make this misuse of this posaconazole and antifungal, which we see another complication. So prophylactically, oral posaconazole only in very high risk patients with very high index of suspicion only. Next please. So in conclusion, what I want to say that there should be attention to warning symptoms and signs with high index of clinical suspicion. This is one of the most important things what we can stress upon. Early diagnosis by a diagnostic endoscopy and direct microscopy of a nasal swab or an endoscopically guided nasal swab, supported by good contrast enhanced MRI or CT scan, initiation of full dose rhizotomal amphotericin B while awaiting the results of culture and histopathology, and while being ready for the surgery, identification of indications for paranasal sinus surgery and orbital exenteration and meticulous post-surgical management. And last but not least, the continued step-down oral antifungals until clinical and radiologically monitored resolution and beyond may help optimize the outcome of ROCM in the settings of COVID-19. Lastly, I would thank all of you for patience listening.
Thank you, Dr. Akhil. You have given a very informative, elaborate, and a clear message that we all should be aware. Now I welcome Dr. Deepak Singh. Dr. Deepak Singh,
hello.
Are you there?
Yes, sir, he's there.
Yeah. So, though it was very detailed, which we all should know also. So let's go with Dr. Deepak Singh. Primarily on surgical management. Dr. Deepak, please proceed.
Yeah.
Our delegate strength is 90 around.
So once it touched to 96 also.
Yeah, I know. I think Dr. Deepak, it will be insert.
First slide. Good afternoon, everyone. Dear Chairman, sir, all my colleagues, all doctors, and all non-medicals and paramedical staff which are here to listen to us. तो कल डॉक्टर सरीना में बैठ के बात कर रहे थे कि ये जो टॉपिक है काफी नया है और काफी नए केसेस देखने को मिल रहे हैं, तो बहुत लिटरेचर है नहीं. तो डॉक्टर अखिल सरीना, हमने डिसाइड किया कि डॉक्टर अखिल सरीन, चूंकि वो एंटी स्पेशलिस्ट हैं और वो काफी टाइम से शुरुआत से ऐसे केसेस देख रहे हैं, तो ही कवर द एकेडमिक पार्ट एंड आई कवर द पार्ट विच विल हेल्प द पीपल टू रिकॉग्नाइज द डिजीज अर्ली. इट विल हेल्प पीपल हु आर नॉन मेडिकोज कि वो अपने परिवार में, अपने अगल बगल में पहचाने और पेशेंट को रेफर कर पाए या बता पाए कि कोई परेशानी हो सकती है. और जो डॉक्टर्स हैं जो इसको बहुत पहली बार देख रहे हैं, शायद कई डॉक्टर्स इनको देखा नहीं होगा. हम सब ऑन्कोलॉजिस्ट का एक्सपोजर इसलिए है क्योंकि हम लोग ना फंगल इन्फेक्शन हमेशा देखते हैं, चाहे वो रेडिएशन ऑन्कोलॉजिस्ट हो, चाहे हमारे बाकी मेडिकल ऑन्कोलॉजिस्ट हो जो इम्यून सप्रेशन यूज करते हैं, या फिर चाहे हम खुद हों. तो टुडे का टॉपिक इज म्यूकरमाइकोसिस, अनसुपरवाइज्ड ओवर द काउंटर मेडिकेशन फॉर एन आइट्रोजेनिक क्राइसिस इन कोविड-19. Next slide, please. So the first thing before we go through the slides is that we should understand the basics of any disease or any topic, and then after we have segregated ki is patient ka kya karna hai, we should refer them to expert and leave the actual management to the experts only. So the best advice that anybody can give to a colleague or relative hai, apna aapko rishtedar hai, koi dost hai, koi padosi hai, use sahi expert ke paas bheja jaye sahi bimari ke liye. तो अब हम शुरुआत करेंगे. हमारी जो हेड एंड नेक की डिजीज मैनेजमेंट ग्रुप है जिसमें सर्जन है डॉक्टर अखिल, डॉक्टर दीपक, डॉक्टर अजय हमारे इंडिविजुअल सर्जन है, डॉक्टर अनुराग हमारे सीनियर कलीग हैं. तो कोविड एनेस्थीसिया की जो टीम है जो डॉक्टर सुमित और डॉक्टर अभिषेक की देखरेख में है, हमारे जो तीन रेडियोलॉजिस्ट हैं डॉक्टर सुनील गौर एंड डॉक्टर कमलेश, और हमारे जो पैथोलॉजिस्ट हैं तीन डॉक्टर गानेंद्र सर, डॉक्टर संदीप एंड डॉक्टर स्वाति. देन वी हैव इम्यूनोलॉजिस्ट इन द फॉर्म ऑफ डॉक्टर अनुश्री, डॉक्टर अंकिता, नेहा एंड डॉक्टर गौरव. Because these people are being using immunotherapy, and these people have seen these diseases before the COVID also. And then we have our pulmonologist, Dr. Vinod and Dr. Vinod KK. There are two with the same names. And then we have our medicine expert, Dr. Santosh and Dr. Rahul. And these people, under the able guidance of Dr. S.K. Singh sir and Director Dr. Swarup and Dr. Ankita, with the nursing team and the dedicated staff, including from the PO into sweeper to the elite most doctors, they coordinate everything and make it a success. So the first thing, that issue that comes in mind is, Dr. Akhil Sen already spoke about, is the unsupervised drug use. Jab hum koi ek drug dete hain mareez ko, to bimari mein drug dena ye decide kiya jata hai. Uske baad fir hum dekhte hain ki mareez ko koi pareshani hai pehle se, BP, sugar, kidney failure, liver ki bimariyan, aisi koi dikkatein hain jiski wajah se wo usko dawa nahi di ja sakti, ya fir dawa mein dose ka badlav karna hai, फिर दवा में समय का बदलाव करना है ताकि डोज अलग कर सकें, वो दवाएं कितने दिन चलेंगी, उस दवाओं का आपस में कोई इंट्रैक्शन है कि नहीं, बिना ये जाने समझे व्हाट्सएप फॉरवर्ड में जो 7-8 दवाई आती हैं लोग उसे चलाए जा रहे हैं. पहले सिर्फ आइवरमेक्टिन और डॉक्साइक्लिन था, लेकिन अब डेक्सोना, डेफ्लोसोफोर्ट, मिथाइलप्रेडनिसोलोन की टैबलेट, इंजेक्शन, सब व्हाट्सएप फॉरवर्ड पे ही चल रहा है. फिर चाहे वो आपके वेलविशर हो, चाहे नेबर हो, गोली आपको खानी है और गोली आप ही खाएंगे, नुकसान आप ही को होगा. स्टेरॉइड और ना थायराइड हार्मोन एक ऐसी चीजें हैं जो नेचुरली बॉडी में पाई जाती है, जिनका पूरी बॉडी में कुछ कंट्रोल या कोई ना कोई मैकेनिज्म से ना कुछ बदलाव करने का ताकत होता है. तो जो स्टेरॉइड होता है वो बेसिकली आपकी बॉडी में ना एक तरह का इम्यूनो सप्रेशन चालू करता है, आपकी बॉडी को इम्यूनिटी को हल्की सी कम करता है और उसको मॉड्यूलेट करता है ताकि आप अपनी बॉडी को ही ना किसी कोविड के इन्फेक्शन के दौरान नष्ट ना कर दें। तो ये उसका एक बेसिक मैकेनिज्म है जो कि एक लेमन भाषा में आपको समझाया जा सकता है। और दूसरा है, कुछ लोग ऐसे हैं जो पहले कोविड से बच के कोरोना वॉरियर बन गए हैं और वो खुद से दवा खा रहे हैं, तो वैसा नहीं है। Then second thing is roots of infection. Now we'll come to the actual fungal infection, be it mucormycosis or be it other fungal infection, either pulmonary. तो जब लोगों को वो हॉस्पिटल में आते हैं या बाहर रहते हैं तो वो शायद सांस में द्वारा वो अंदर जाती हैं, या फिर आपने कोई इन्फेक्टेड खाना खा लिया गंदे हाथों से बिना हाथ धोए तो वो जा सकता है, क्योंकि मिट्टी में हवा में हर जगह पाया जाता है। तीसरा है बार बार ना अपने नाकों में उंगली करना, या ऐसे नोज पिकिंग कहते हैं, या फिर आप बिना हाथ धोए अपने नोज को बार बार ट्रॉमा पहुंचाते हैं तो उस जगह पे भी ना एक घाव सा बनते वहां पे ना फंगल इन्फेक्शन चालू हो जाते हैं। तो नाउ पैथोफिजियोलॉजी में ऑलरेडी डॉक्टर साक्षी ने बताया है एंजियो इन्वेशन जो वेसल के अंदर घुस करके थ्रोम्बोसिस करके उस पूरी टिश्यू को सड़ा देता है, जहां इन्फेक्शन होता है वो काली पड़ जाती है। फिर है स्टैट्स। तो अब हम आपको बताएं, जब कोविड नहीं था तो करीबन 1% लोगों में जिनकी इम्यूनिटी कम थी ये बीमारी पाई जाती थी RCM, लेकिन अब ना इसकी जो मोर्टालिटी थी वो तब से ही 50-85% के आसपास है। मतलब हो सकता है कि आधे लोग भी इनको बीमारी हो वो बिना इलाज के सर्वाइव ना कर पाए, और प्राय पाया गया है कि ये मर्दों और औरतों में बराबर ही मात्रा में पाया जाता है इंसिडेंस में। तो किस किस तरीके से होते हैं, ये है क्राइनोसेरेबल जिसके बारे में डॉक्टर अखिल ने ऑलरेडी बताया RCM के बारे में। दूसरा है पल्मोनरी जिसके भी कुछ केसेस पाए गए हैं। तीसरा गैस्ट्रोइंटेस्टिनल जो थोड़ा कम पाया जा रहा है कोविड के बाद, और उसके बाद है प्राइमरी क्यूटेनियस जो चमड़ी में होता है, और एक होता है डिसिमिनेटेड जो ना पूरे शरीर में फैल चुका है। तो राइनोसेरिब्रल का जो इंसिडेंस है वो सबसे ज्यादा है RCM, जिसके बारे में डॉक्टर अखिल सेन ने हमने विस्तार से बताया है। अब ऐसे कौन कौन से फैक्टर हैं जो ना या फिर कारक बन सकते हैं आपको ये इन्फेक्शन होने के। पहला तो एक डायबिटिक कीटोएसिडोसिस है जो कि ना राइनोसेरिब्रल के लिए बहुत बड़ा कॉज है। अनकंट्रोल्ड डायबिटीज है, या फिर किसी पेशेंट को ना बहुत लंबे समय तक 2 या 3 हफ्ते के ऊपर वेंटिलेटर पर रहना पड़ गया, या फिर ट्रेकोस्मी पे, या फिर कोई इम्यूनो मॉड्यूलेटरी एजेंट जैसे कि टोक्लिज़ुमाब से चल रहा है, कई लोग बेवासिज़ुमाब भी यूज कर रहे हैं, तो ऐसी ड्रग्स की वजह से भी, इम्यूनो मॉड्यूलेशन की वजह से भी हो सकता है। फिर है जिन मरीजों को ना भर्ती के दौरान कंडीशन खराब होती है, उनका CRP वगैरह बढ़ा होता है, उनमें होने का रिस्क ज्यादा होता है। और अगर आप बेतरतीब तरीके से स्टेरॉइड यूज कर रहे हैं, भले आपको डायबिटीज हो ना हो, तो आपको पल्मोनरी राइनोसेरेब्रल या फिर पूरा फैला हुआ ये जो माइकोसिस है उसको होने का डर रहता है। और अगर आपने खाना पीना ठीक से नहीं खाया है कोविड के दौरान, तो GI ट्रैक्ट यानी कि ना आपकी जो आंतों हैं उनमें भी इन्फेक्शन होने का डर रहता है। कुछ विशेष बातें जो आप यहाँ बताना चाहेंगे, कभी कभी बैक्टीरिया के इन्फेक्शन या फिर फंगस के इन्फेक्शन से बचने के लिए हम पेशेंट्स को ICU में या फिर कोविड के दौरान भर्ती के दौरान वोरिकोनाजोल या फिर 1-2 एंटीफंगल देते हैं। तो जो एंटीफंगल म्यूकर के खिलाफ काम नहीं करते, उनमें ऐसा पाया गया है कि एस्पर्जिलोसिस के लिए इलाज करते समय या फिर उसको प्रोफाइलेक्सिस देते समय उनमें थोड़ी ना ज्यादा मात्रा में म्यूकर की ना प्रॉब्लम पाई गई है। तो पर से दवाइयों से तो इन्फेक्शन नहीं होता वोरिकोनाजोल से, लेकिन उनमें जो इन्फेक्शन की दर है बढ़ जाती है, क्योंकि फिर दूसरी एंटीफंगल चालू कर रहे होते हैं जो म्यूकर में काम नहीं करती। दूसरा, ऐसे मरीज जो HIV/AIDS के हैं या फिर क्रोनिक किडनी डिजीज के हैं, किडनी खराब है जिनका, डायलिसिस चल रहा है, या फिर जो ट्रांसप्लांट कराए हुए हैं, या फिर जिनका लिवर फेल है किसी कारण से, उनमें भी होने का खतरा ज्यादा होता है। नेक्स्ट इज रिस्क इन डायबिटीज। तो डायबिटीज में रिस्क बढ़ क्यों जाता है? पहली बात तो ये है कि नॉर्मल पॉपुलेशन में भी बिना कोविड के भी 50% जो केसेस होते हैं म्यूकर के वो डायबिटीज मरीजों में होते हैं। तो ये नॉन कोविड का डेटा है, तो आप जान सकते हैं कि कोविड के बाद तो ये और ज्यादा बढ़ गया होगा। कारण है डायबिटिक कीटोएसिडोसिस, अनकंट्रोल्ड डायबिटीज, क्योंकि आप दवा ऊपर नीचे करके आप लोग खाना बंद कर देते हैं या फिर ठीक तरीके से खाते नहीं। फिर उसके बाद है स्टेरॉइड यूज लीडिंग टू अनकंट्रोल्ड डायबिटीज, जो आप बिना किसी सुपरविजन के घर पे खाते हैं, या फिर कई ऐसे लोग जो टैबलेट पे अपने डायबिटीज कंट्रोल करते हैं और स्टेरॉइड साथ में खा लेते हैं, तो वो अपनी टैबलेट को ऊपर नीचे करके मॉड्यूलेट नहीं कर पाते और उन्हें प्रॉब्लम बढ़ जाती है। फिर है डायबिटीज में थोड़ी इम्यूनिटी का भी प्रॉब्लम होता है, जो मेन जो न्यूट्रोफिल का जो एक्शन होता है फंगस को मारने के लिए वो कम हो जाता है डायबिटीज के मरीजों में, इसकी वजह से भी इन्फेक्शन जल्दी फैलता है उनमें। तो कॉम्प्लिकेशन ऑलरेडी डिस्क्राइब हो गए हैं तो उसे जाने का जरूरत नहीं। फिर एक चीज जो डॉक्टर अखिल सरीन नहीं देखते हैं वो है पल्मोनरी म्यूकरमाइकोसिस, क्योंकि कैंसर पेशेंट में न्यूट्रोपिनिया पाई जाती है, इसके भी कुछ केसेस आए हैं कोविड के बाद। तो इसमें क्या होता है, मरीजों की सांस दोबारा फूलने लगती है, उनको खांसी आती है, उनको छाती में बहुत तेज दर्द होता है जो रात को आपको नींद से भी जगा सकता है, बुखार वगैरह आती है, और कभी कभी क्या बोलते हैं बलगम वाली खांसी तो नहीं आती, कभी कभी आपको ना खांसते समय खून आ सकता है।
फिर आप सीटी स्कैन कराते हैं तो आपको ना एक निमोनिया की पिक्चर मिलती है या फिर एक गांठ जैसा कुछ मिल सकता है या फिर कोई इन्फार्क्ट मिलेगा, फॉर आइदर यू कैन फाइंड कैविटेशन और माइसेटोमा पर से। तो राइनोमाइकोसिस या फिर आरसीएम की डीडी क्या है, आप कैसे किससे इनको कंफ्यूज कर सकते हैं? तो हमने अपनी माँ का स्कैन अभी कुछ दिन पहले कराया था कोविड के बाद, और हमें उसमें ना साइनसाइटिस की पिक्चर मिली, क्योंकि हमने यहाँ पे स्कैन करा के दो रेडियोलॉजिस्ट से डिस्कस किया, तो उनको काफी दिन से लोकलाइज हेडेक हो रहा था लेकिन वो राइनोमाइकोसिस नहीं था। तो इसलिए जो हेडेक होता है, तो एक एंटिटी है न्यू डेली परसिस्टेंट हेडेक, तो कई कोविड मरीजों में पाई गई है, उनका हेडेक जो है कई हफ्ते महीनों तक बना रहता है और दवा देने के बाद ही जाता है। दूसरा है राइनोसाइनोसाइटिस, जो एक नॉर्मल साइनोसाइटिस की इन्फेक्शन है जो प्राय लोगों में पाई जाती है, उसको भी लोग कन्फ्यूज कर सकते हैं। फिर कोई दूसरा फंगल इन्फेक्शन हो या फिर अगर ना इन्फेक्शन की वजह से वहाँ पे ना सड़न पैदा हो गई हो सेलाइटिस के फॉर्म में, तो भी आप उसको राइनोमाइकोसिस से कन्फ्यूज कर सकते हैं। अब इसमें सर्जरी का रोल क्या है? सर्जरी में अपना सारी सड़ी हुई चीजें जो ब्लैक अशकार है उसको पूरा निकाल दिया जाता है। इससे फायदा क्या होता है, जो ब्लड में आप एंटी फंगल देते हैं उनका असर ज्यादा अच्छा होता है, क्योंकि जब ब्लड में एंटी फंगल जाता है तो मरी हुई टिश्यू के पास नहीं पहुंच पाता, क्योंकि वहां की एक खून की धमनियां खराब हो चुकी होती हैं। तो इसलिए अगर अपना जो खराब टिश्यू को निकाल देंगे तो बचे हुए जो हेल्दी टिश्यू है उसमें एंटी फंगल अच्छे से पहुंच पाएगा और फंगस की बढ़त को रोकेगा। दूसरा है जो इन्फेक्टेड हेल्दी लुकिंग टिश्यू है उसको भी निकालना है। आप देखेंगे कुछ टिश्यू में फंगस होता है लेकिन वो सड़ी नहीं होती, उसे भी निकालना है, वरना अपना इस सड़न को बढ़ाने से रोक नहीं पाएंगे। इसे थोड़ा सा नॉर्मल टिश्यू भी इसे साथ में निकाल दिया जाता है। दूसरा है जब भी आप कोई इन्वेसिव डायग्नोस्टिक करते हैं, यानी कि ना बिना मरीज को छुए डायग्नोसिस होती है, जैसे कि MRI हो गया, उसमें आप मरीज को छूते नहीं है, कोई स्कोपी नहीं करते, कुछ पिन नहीं लगाते, लेकिन जो नेजल एंडोस्कोपी है जिसमें आप मरीज के अंदर दूरबीन डालते हैं जिसमें मरीज को कुछ कष्ट होने का डर रहता है, उसमें पाया गया है कि अगर आप सैंपल लेते हैं उस तरीके से तो सैंपल की यील्ड बेहतर होती है और डायग्नोसिस पहले होती है। तो इसलिए जो हमारा मोटो होना चाहिए वो होना चाहिए कि आप अर्ली अपने ऐसे किस को रेफर करें, अर्ली इनको डायग्नोज करें, पहचानें या इनको समझने का प्रयास करें और जिंदगी बचाने का प्रयास करें। तो द फर्स्ट थिंग इज नेजल स्टफिनेस और डिस्चार्ज, इट कैन बी ऑफ एनी कलर एनी फॉर्म एंड विद ब्लड ऑल्सो विदाउट ब्लड एंड ब्लैक इन कलर। तो किसी भी तरह का नेजल नाक से डिस्चार्ज जो 7 से 14 दिन के बाद शुरू हो कोविड के ठीक होने के बाद, तो आपको इसके बारे में सोचना चाहिए। दूसरा है किसी एक ही जगह पे बार बार अगर चेहरे पे पेन हो रहा है, आंख के नीचे, आंख के किसी और या फिर नाक के पास, या फिर दांत का दर्द भी नया पहली बार आपको हुआ है, तो आपको थोड़ा सा संभल के रखना चाहिए। दूसरा है किसी एक पर्टिकुलर लोकेशन पे सामने अगर सर दर्द लगातार हो रहा है जो बढ़ता ही जा रहा है, तो हो सकता है आपका कैवेनस साइनस में थ्रोम्बोसिस या फिर इन्फेक्शन हो गया हो जिसकी वजह से ही हो रहा हो, या फिर अगर चेहरे का कोई हिस्सा सुन्न हो जा रहा है, या फिर आंखों में थोड़ा सा रोशनी में बदलाव, आंखें पलट रही हैं, आप दिखाई दे रही हैं। रिक्वेस्ट है प्लीज अपने सॉरी माइक ऑफ कर लें, थैंक यू। अगर आंखों में कुछ दिखने की दिक्कत हो रही है, कुछ सूजन मिल रही है, आंखों में लालिमा है, आंखें बाहर आ रही हैं या फिर आंखें धस भी रही हैं, या फिर आपको दो दिख रहा है दिखाई नहीं दे रहा, और कोई भी नई परेशानी जो पहले नहीं थी चेहरे पे, सूजन, लालिमा, कालापन, तो आपको आके डॉक्टर से मिलना है। तो जो एंडोस्कोपिक अप्रोच है उसके 3 काम हैं जो ऑलरेडी डिस्क्राइब किए गए हैं सर द्वारा। पहला तो ना डायग्नोसिस का बहुत बड़ा रोल है, डायग्नोसिस में रोल है कि आप देख के पहचान सकते हैं, आप देख के सैंपल ले सकते हैं और ना इसे पहले ही पकड़ सकते हैं, क्योंकि जैसा कि बताया डॉक्टर साहब ने, सीटी स्कैन या MRI में जो आप देखेंगे, आप ना अगर मरीज को अपने सामने बैठ के देखें क्लिनिकली स्कोपी द्वारा, तो ना जो दिक्कतें हैं वो करीबन 18 से 36 घंटे पहले पकड़ में आती हैं, जब तक कि सब कुछ नष्ट होकर सड़ ना गया हो। फिर है ट्रीटमेंट, तो ट्रीटमेंट में एंडोस्कोपिक का जो मेन रोल है, एंडोस्कोपी इज द मेन ट्रीटमेंट फॉर ऑरली केसेस। आई मीन द टीम जस्ट बिकॉज वी आर गेटिंग एडवांस केसेस, न्यूरोसर्जन जो हमारे डॉक्टर अजय हैं वो आते हैं और हमारी हेल्प करते हैं ऐसे केसेस में जिसमें मैनेजर से भी जा चुकी होती है। फिर है फॉलोअप में हम क्या करते हैं, हर 2-3 दिन पे ना जिनका ऑपरेशन हो गया है उनकी पट्टी करके, पट्टी निकाल के या एम्पुटेशन से भिगा के कभी कभी देखा जाता है, ये देखने के लिए कि बीमारी आगे बढ़ गई है कि रुक गई है, और बीमारी में अगर बढ़ रहा है फिर प्रॉब्लम है तो हम लोग दोबारा ऑपरेशन कर सकते हैं एंडोस्कोपी द्वारा, या फिर एंडोस्कोपी से देख के वहाँ एम्फोट्रेसिन बी का ना लगा सकते हैं, या फिर एक नया सैंपल ले सकते हैं, और ठीक होने के बाद भी आपको रूटीनली एंडोस्कोपी कराएंगे तो वो ज़्यादा आसान पड़ेगा बजाय बार बार कोई स्कैन या सीटी कराएं। तो द कंक्लूजन इज अर्ली डायग्नोसिस एंड अर्ली ट्रीटमेंट रिड्यूसेस मोर्टैलिटी। जो लोग शुरुआती दौर में आते हैं स्टेज 1 या स्टेज 2 में, उनका इलाज भी आसान होता है, वो लोग कम दिन हॉस्पिटल में रहते भी हैं, परेशानी भी कम होती है, और अपने चेहरे का कोई अटूट हिस्सा जैसे कि आंख वगैरह खोने का खतरा भी कम रहता है। तो इसलिए आप थोड़ा डर से या फिर ना क्या बोलते हैं जागरूक होके पहले आते हैं, अपने डाउट को क्लियर करते हैं और एंडोस्कोपी कराते हैं तो बेहतर रहेगा कि बोलते हैं अर्ली स्टेज पकड़ में आएगी और आपको बेहतर इलाज मिलेगा। क्योंकि जितनी बड़ी बीमारी होगी उतना बड़ा ऑपरेशन होगा, इसमें साफ साफ ही आप समझ सकते हैं। तो इतना शुरुआती छोटी बीमारी पकड़ में आती है, ऑपरेशन उतना कम छोटा उतना ही कम हॉस्पिटल स्टे वाला होता है। फिर है जो अंडरलाइन फैक्टर्स हैं उसको रिवर्स करना है, जैसे कि स्टेरॉइड बिना किसी से बताइए मत खाइए, डायबिटीज को ना लगातार नापिए अपने डॉक्टर की सलाह के साथ या फिर खुद ही, और उसका अच्छे से मॉनिटरिंग करिए, उसे ना कंट्रोल में रखिए। फिर ना कोई भी इम्यूनोसप्रेशन वगैरह चल रहा है अपने डॉक्टर से उस बारे में समझें कि कब उन्हें आके दोबारा मिलना है या दिखाना है, और कोई भी नया साइन उत्पन्न होने पे कुछ भी दिक्कत होने में तुरंत आके डॉक्टर से मिलिए और देखा देखी कि उनको इतना डेक्सोना मिला है, उनको इतना मिथाइल प्रेडनिसोल मिला है, वो 60 kg के हैं, आप 100 kg के हैं, तो आप ना कितना भी पढ़ के ना अपना स्टेरॉइड खुद मॉनिटर करके सही डोज में नहीं दे पाएंगे और ये डिसाइड नहीं कर पाएंगे कब शुरू करना है कब खत्म करना है। तो बेहतर है कि जो इंडिविजुअल ट्रीटमेंट है उसका ऑप्शन अपने डॉक्टर को दें और उसे ही सब करने दें। तो जैसा कि लॉरेंस जे पीटर ने कहा है, जो बहुत अच्छे कैनेडियन थिंकर हैं, एक्सपर्ट वो है जो ना तीनों बार तुक्का लगाए उसके तीनों तुक्के सही हों। इसका मतलब ये है कि सीधे तौर पे वो तुक्का नहीं लगाते, वही एक्सपर्ट होते हैं। तो बेहतर है अपने लाइफ और अपना जो आगे का ट्रीटमेंट है एक्सपर्ट पे छोड़ें और उनको डिसाइड करने दें, स्पेशली जब एक बड़ी टीम हो जो आपको बेस्ट पॉसिबल ट्रीटमेंट प्रोवाइड कर सके। थैंक यू। अब मैं डॉक्टर सरीन यहाँ पे हैं, अगर आपके मन में भी सवाल है तो आप पूछ सकते हैं हम दोनों से।
Informative and well in time. So any person can ask directly any question to Dr. Akhil, Dr. Deepak, or you can talk personally also. You can take the number also. Finish in very well time. So you can go with the question answer. Thank you very much for attending, and Dr. To the faculty also. हमारे ख्याल से बहुत क्लियर था आप लोगों का डिलीवरेशन और सब लोगों ने बहुत अच्छे से अटेंड भी किया है और क्वेश्चन आंसर पर्सनली होगा, अगर कोई क्वेश्चन होगा तो सबको क्लियरिटी है। वंस अगेन थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर फिनिशिंग इन टाइम, नियर अबाउट इन टाइम एंड रियली गिविंग वेरी क्लियर इन्फॉर्मेशन। ओके थैंक यू, बाय बाय टू एवरीबॉडी।
धन्यवाद। ओके
इतना रेलगाड़ी इधर पढ़े तो हमने साइड छोटी बनाई थी।